Welcome aboard. Welcome to today's tour. Today, we are in Orlando, Florida at the Orlando Executive Airport. We're in Orlando today because in 1982, Ozzy Osbourne was on his way to perform here in Orlando during his Diary of a Madman tour when the band suffered what would be an odd tragedy for a group traveling by tour bus. Let me get the plane started and I'll get the cockpit set up and we will get underway. Three people, including the lead guitarist Randy Rhoads, were killed here in a plane crash. Today, we will end up talking about how the group ended up here in Leesburg, Florida, and how the plane crash occurred. The crash involved a Beechcraft F-35 Bonanza, and today, here in the simulator, we are in a Beechcraft Bonanza G-36. Just let me point out that the intent today is to talk about the events and find the locations here in the flight simulator, and not to recreate the actual aviation event. Someone will inevitably point out that we're in the wrong aircraft, or have the wrong instruments, or inaccurate weather, etc. It's not the intent, but the bonanza we are in makes sense for the story we are discussing. The plane has started. The Orlando Executive Airport here has the airport code KORL and is located 3 miles or 6 kilometers from downtown Orlando. It's a general and corporate aviation facility. Let's take a look at our flight plan today. Pretty straight, short flight to the location of where the crash took place at a small private airstrip in Leesburg, Florida. Let's make our way to the runway and we will get the plane in the air. If this is your first time with us, welcome. What we do here is we find locations that have interesting stories, and we find them here in Microsoft Flight Simulator.
Seven incredible years with Black Sabbath serve only as a foreshadowing of the savage raw power dying to be released. The wild-eyed maniac is back, and he's coming straight for your soul. The 1982 World Tour is yours. Take it. Enter the world of a madman, Ozzy Osbourne.
Known for his heavy metal music style, also known as the Prince of Darkness or the Madman of Metal, Ozzy Osbourne is an English singer and songwriter from Birmingham, England. He was a founding member of the band Black Sabbath, which laid the foundation for heavy metal in the 1970s. After leaving Sabbath, in 1978, Ozzy started his solo career. Ozzy was on the North American leg of his Diary of a Madman tour in March of 1982. The band had performed in front of a sold-out crowd at the Knoxville Civic Coliseum on March 18th and was on their way to play at the Rock Super Bowl. The Rock Super Bowl was a reoccurring rock festival held from 1977 to 1983 at the Tangerine Bowl here in Orlando, Florida. We will pass over that venue, which is now known as Camping World Stadium. While on their way to Orlando, the tour bus had some mechanical issues and needed repairs made to the air conditioning unit. At the time of the incident, Ozzy's band featured Randy Rhoads as the guitar player, Rudy Sarzo as the bass player, and keyboardist Don Airey and drummer Tommy Aldridge. The tour bus was owned and operated by Calhoun Brothers Tour Bus Company, which was located in Leesburg, Florida. The company was owned by Jerry Calhoun. Jerry was also an accomplished musician. The Calhoun twins were a country group consisting of Jack and his twin brother Jerry Calhoun. We are at the hold short line. We will be in the air shortly. Since the location of the tour bus company was in Leesburg, close to Orlando, the bus driver had made the decision to stop there to have repairs made to the air conditioning. The tour bus driver was Andrew Acock, who worked for Jack Calhoun's tour bus company and also lived near Jack. The group left Knoxville, and after driving much of the night in the large luxury tour bus that had a brown top, white bottom, and equestrian art on the sides, they stopped at the Flying Baron Estates, a property belonging to Jerry Calhoun, the owner of what is now Florida Coach, and again was the manufacturer in Leesburg. racer of these touring motor coaches. It was about 8 a.m. on the morning of March 19th when the tour bus arrived at the property in Leesburg, where there was a small airstrip lined with planes and three houses. One belonged to the tour bus driver, Andrew Acock, and another, a white Georgian-style mansion, was owned by Jerry Calhoun. After arriving, Andrew Acock and his ex-wife Wanda, who was also on the tour bus, went into Calhoun's house to make some coffee, while other members of Ozzy's band slept in the bus. We are approaching Camping World Stadium here in Orlando. This was also known as the Tangerine Bowl at one point, and this is where the Rock Super Bowl concert was to be held that Ozzy Osbourne was on his way to. Sometime later, Acock, who was also a pilot, although his license was expired at the time, decided to take the liberty of doing some flying in a 1955 Beechcraft Bonanza F-35, registration number N567LT, that was stored in a nearby hangar. The plane belonged to Mike Parton. He had no knowledge of the flight and had not given anybody permission to use it. Beechcraft Bonanza is an American general aviation aircraft introduced in 1947 by Beech Aircraft Corporation. It's a six-seater, single-engine aircraft that's still produced by Beechcraft. Andrew Acock, again the tour bus driver, talked Don Airy, the keyboardist, into taking a flight with him, as well as the tour manager, Jake Duncan. The short flight, during which he made several low passes at treetop level over the area, ended and the plane landed safely. Acock then took Randy Rhoads and Rachel Youngblood on another flight. Rachel Youngblood was the group's makeup artist, hairdresser, and seamstress. She had worked for Sharon Osbourne's family for years. Sharon, Ozzy's wife, who was Ozzy's fiance at the time, Sharon Arden, said that Rachel was like a mother she never had. Randy Rhoads was Ozzy's guitar player and may have been on his way to becoming one of the greatest rock guitar players of all time. He recorded two multi-platinum albums with Ozzy in just 2 years. The guitar virtuoso was named Guitar Player Magazine's Best New Talent of 1981. Randall William Randy Rhoads was born on December 6, 1956 in Santa Monica, California. The youngest of three children, he started playing guitar at the age of six on his grandfather's old Gibson acoustic guitar and learned to play folk guitar, which was a common way to learn guitar at the time. After his parents divorced, his mother, Dolores, who had received a degree in music from UCLA and had played piano professionally, opened Musonia Music School. Randy and his siblings would take lessons here and would eventually go on to teach at the school as well. Randy played throughout high school. He became a heavy metal guitarist who played with the band Quiet Riot before joining Ozzy. At age 16, Randy and a friend, Kelly Garney, had formed the band Little Woman. At approximately the same time, Rhoads began teaching guitar in his mother's school during the day and playing live gigs at night. Recruiting lead vocalist Kevin DeBrow and drummer Drew Forsyth, the band soon changed its name to Quiet Riot. The band had some success on the Los Angeles club scene and released a couple of albums for Sony Records. Randy's brother says that a July 11th, 1971 Alice Cooper concert at the Long Beach Auditorium that they attended was the defining point in Randy's musical progression. Randy was mesmerized, just staring at the stage. Later that night, Randy said, "I can do this. I can look like this. I can be this." Something clicked that night, and I think that kind of showed him what he could do with his talent. Rhoads received a call to audition for Ozzy, who was looking for a guitar player, just before his final show with Quiet Riot in September of 1979. It was the day before Ozzy was scheduled to return to England, so Randy agreed and auditioned for Ozzy at the Los Angeles studio. After the audition, Ozzy would say that he immediately gave him the job. Randy recalls later, "I was just tuning up and playing some riffs," and he says, "You've got the gig. I had the weirdest feeling because I thought you didn't even hear me play yet." Randy's masterful ability to bridge rock and classical techniques helped him found a groundbreaking style of guitar playing, as evidenced in his playing style on songs including Crazy Train, Mr. Crowley, and Flying High Again. Now on tour with Ozzy and at this small airfield just outside of Orlando, Andrew persuaded Randy to go on the second flight despite his fear of flying. They believe that Randy apparently agreed to go since Rachel had a heart condition, so Andrew agreed not to do anything too risky. Randy also wanted to take some aerial photos. One of his hobbies was photography. Randy had tried to get Rudy Sarzo, the bassist, on board as well, but Sarzo decided to stay in bed and get some extra sleep. During the second flight, attempts were made to buzz the tour bus, which was parked about 60 feet from Calhoun's mansion, and where the other band members, Ozzy, his manager, his future wife Sharon, Tommy Aldridge, and Rudy Sarzo were sleeping. Don Airy was still standing outside and was watching the flight. The Bonanza succeeded a couple times, but the last attempt went seriously wrong. One of the plane's wings clipped the bus, sending the aircraft spiraling. It then skimmed the top of some trees before crashing into the garage and exploding into flames. All three passengers were killed instantly and were burned beyond recognition. Randy was ultimately identified by dental records and his jewelry. Don Airy was the only person to witness the crash. We are approaching Leesburg, the area where the tour bus stopped on that night. It's where the small airstrip is and some houses. The pilot, who had not only taken the plane without permission, had been up all night apparently using cocaine. This would later be confirmed by toxicology reports following the crash. It would later be discovered that ACOC had an expired pilot's license and 6 years earlier had been involved in another fatal helicopter crash. Ozzy was still sleeping when he heard the crash. He told investigators, "At approximately 9 a.m. on Friday, March 19, 1982, I was awoken from my sleep by a loud explosion. I immediately thought that we'd been in a vehicle crash since I thought we were on the road heading to the next hotel." Ozzy went into more detail in his book, I Am Ozzy. "After the crash, I looked for an emergency exit. There wasn't one, so I ran to the open door at the front of the bus instead, dragging Sharon behind me. I then looked around for the others, but all the bunks were empty. Where the fuck had everyone gone? Where the hell was Randy? I jumped out of the bus and landed on the grass." Grass? At that point, I thought I must be dreaming. Where was the road? Where were the cars? I'd expected to see twisted metal, blood, spinning hubcaps, but we were parked in the middle of a field surrounded by a bunch of over-the-top coke dealer-style mansions. Then, next to one of the houses, there was a gigantic fireball, like something from a James Bond film. Sharon was asking Don what happened, but he was crouched down in a ball and could not speak. She asked repeatedly, "Where was Randy and Rachel?" And finally, he just pointed towards the flames. Sharon repeated, "I don't understand. I don't understand." I couldn't understand either. Nobody had said, "Oh, by the way, Ozzy, on the way to Orlando, we're going to stop off at a bus depot in Leesburg to fix the air conditioning." Nobody had said, "Oh, by the way, Ozzy, the bus depot is part of a dodgy housing estate with an airstrip." Nobody had said, "Oh yeah, and your driver, who's been up all night, out of his mind on cocaine, also happens to be a pilot with an expired medical certificate, who's going to borrow some bloke's plane without his permission, and then while you're fast asleep, take your lead guitarist and your makeup artist on a sightseeing trip above the tour bus before dive bombing it into the ground." Nobody had said anything like that at all. That was a bit of the tragedy that took the lives of three people here in Leesburg, Florida on March of 1982. As you can imagine, Ozzy and the other band members took it hard, and the tour didn't resume for a few weeks. We will make a turn now, head out past the field a bit so that we can land here and take a look around the airfield, and we will be on the ground here in Leesburg shortly. The price of today's tour is pretty reasonable. If you could just reach down and hit that subscribe button, it really does help the channel, and I appreciate it. Let's get the plane on the ground.
March 19th, 1982. Touring in support of the Diary of a Madman album, The Hand of Fate made a heartbreaking entry in Ozzy's personal diary. A triple tragedy devastated Osbourne's tour. In my April 1982 interview, Ozzy spoke publicly for the first time about the freak private plane crash that killed his tour bus driver, his wardrobe seamstress, and his guitarist, Randy Rhoads.
What happened was we did a gig in Knoxville, Tennessee, and we'd driven through the night from Knoxville, and we were going to do a show with Foreigner down in Orlando. And as it happens, the bus depot is in Orlando, and we had to stop it off at the depot to get some parts for the bus. I think it was a jack or something. And I'd gone to bed very late that night. I was talking to Randy till about the early hours of the morning. We were talking about, because he wanted to do his idea was to go to college and get a degree in classical music. And I said, "Well, you know, wait till the end of the tour and we'll talk again." And we were just having a general rap, you know. And I went to bed at the back of the bus with my wife. The next minute I know, I'm woken up with this almighty bang on the bus. It's like a terrific explosion. And I looked down the other end of the bus, and there was all this broken glass down the other end of the bus. And I said to Sharon, "We've had an accident." I'm still thinking we're on the freeway. So I run down the bus, I look out the window, and we're in the middle of a field, and I'm thinking, I don't know where the hell I am. And I run back, put some pants on, grab my wife, and got off the bus. And the bus was virtually cut in half. And what had happened was the driver of the bus also had a private pilot's license, and that is a smaller airstrip on the bus depot. But it's a big area, you know. So he took the guys up to take an aerial photograph of the bus and whatever, and he made an error with one of his judgments and clipped the side of the bus with the wing of the plane and exploded into this big house. And the autopsy said that Randy was killed instantaneously. So that, I mean, it's tragic that he went, but it's nice to know that he didn't suffer at all.
Welcome to the Flying Baron Estates, a small airfield with the airport code 10FA, and the runway length here is 2,575 feet or 785 meters. It's a private airfield here located among a few houses. One of the houses was Jerry Calhoun's mansion, who also owned the tour bus company where they manufacture and lease these tour buses. Here in the simulator, it does show a house where Calhoun's mansion was, although his house is white, but this is the location where the house is shown, and the tour bus was parked out to the right here, about 60 feet from the house.